Good day, kapamilya. Maraming salamat sa paglago niyo dito sa TFC News. Today, we have a very, very special guest joining us all the way from Japan. She is one of the 19 Filipino athletes who will be representing the Philippines in the upcoming Tokyo Olympics. And we have a rare opportunity to sit down with her to get to know more about her story, what makes her tick, and why she's so proud to represent the Philippines. Please welcome Philippine team member Christina Knott. Christina, hello. All the way there in Japan. Hello from San Francisco here in the Bay Area. First of all, how are you doing? Thanks for your time, for spending your time with us and here in TFC News. First up, tell us how you're doing so far there in Japan.
So far, Japan has been well. Obviously, you know, it's day four, so I'm still trying to get adjusted to the time zone because I'm coming from Texas. So, you know, that 12-hour difference is something I have to get back used to, because the last time I've been on this side of the world was 2 years ago. So it's definitely an adjustment.
All right. Well, we understand that before you make your trek to Tokyo to get into the Olympic Village, you are doing your last leg of training there in Isahi. Isahi, is that correct? Tell us a bit more about this, how your team decided to train there, who's taking care of you, and what it's been like so far in your last few days of training and preparing yourself for the Olympics.
Yeah, so, you know, we're doing the normal practice, it's just a different setting. The only difference is we are trying to train according to what the time that I will race. So I will run at 10:30 a.m. Japanese time. So, you know, just getting up early in the morning to eat breakfast and, you know, kind of like mock how August 2nd is going to go for me. That's the biggest change, I would say, as far as training for me.
I see. Well, right now, it's interesting to speak to you, one of the 19 Olympians we have, because the spotlight is on all of you right now. And the last time you were, you know, of course, in the consciousness of all the Filipinos was the SEA Games, where you did so great. You won the medals. You broke the records. What has it been like since that moment when you were thrust into the attention of the Filipino crowd and then they embrace you with so much love and joy for bringing pride to the country? What has a ride been like for you and all the way to now taking yourself to the Olympics?
Hearing the love that I got from the SEA Games to now has been overwhelmingly bigger than the SEA Games, because at the SEA Games, I feel like the love was more local, and now I'm getting, you know, messages from people from like Canada, a lot of Americans who are supporting me. A lot of them come from like California, the Bay Area. Mm-hmm. So just seeing how big the Filipino pride community is, you know, it exceeds far beyond, you know, just the Philippines, and just getting love from around the world is super encouraging.
Awesome. Well, let's jump into right that. I mean, I wanted to talk to you about your history to introduce you more to our TFC audience. I mean, we cater to the Filipinos in all over the world. Outside of the Philippines, TFC is the Filipino channel. So I'm in North America. We have the Filipino channel in Europe, Middle East, and Asia. And as you said, you're getting the love from everywhere. Tell us about your story. I know you're from Florida, right? And tell us a bit about how it was like growing up and how you got yourself into athletics and how you got into running.
I born and raised from Orlando, Florida. Initially, my first sport was basketball. Wow. I did track and field. Oh, no, honey. Sorry. I did track and field to stay in shape for basketball. Oh. So I started running track at the age of 12, middle school. Didn't really take it serious. Took it more serious in high school just for the fact to, you know, get out of Orlando, and I was able to get a full ride scholarship at Arkansas State, and then I ended up transferring to Miami. Mm-hmm. And my roommate was friends with Eric Cray, who was a 400-meter hurdler on the team. And I remember watching the 2016 Olympics in the cast with some friends, and them saying like, oh, like they know this person and this person. And they were calling out people that weren't American. Mm-hmm. I was like, how do you know them? And, you know, they're not representing America. And they're like, oh, they're representing like either where they're from or where their mother's from. So that kind of sparked the idea of me like running professional and running for the Philippines. So that was just a thought. And then fast forward to my junior year is when I transferred to Miami. I met my roommate who was friends with Eric Cray. She gave me his contact. Me and him talked a little bit. And it was just like, okay, like just like a thought, you know? And I remember, so we used to do team building things at Miami. And one of the things that we did was a vision board of, you know, like our dreams and stuff like that. And I remember putting the Filipino flag on my vision board my junior year. And I was like, it would be so cool if I can, you know, represent the Philippines and hope to, you know, take it to the biggest world stage. You know, just these are all just like thoughts or whatever. So senior year comes around. My coach or the men's sprint coach knows my current coach right now. My current coach was the head coach for the Philippines team. And I remember him coming up to me. It was like the beginning of track season. He was like, mm-hmm. Hey, KK, do you still have aspirations to run for the Philippines? And I was like, I mean, if the opportunity presents itself, yeah, why? He was like, because I know the head coach for the Philippines. And I was like, okay, so he got in contact with me, and then I got in contact with Dr. Rico, and then we worked out the citizenship, and here I am.
What a story. I mean, we didn't realize we had to thank Eric for so much of this, for the connection, but hey, that's how it works. Filipinos, it's who you know. Sometimes it's your relative, your tita, or all that. But tell us about the reaction of your family from your mom's side when they found out that, hey, it's for real. You're finally going to represent the Philippines.
It hit them. I think it's starting to hit them now that, like, you know, love is coming in. Because at first it was just like, okay, like, she's just going to do that. I mean, maybe I didn't never really ask, but I would say my mom was, like, super proud. She's, like, showing her coworkers. She's, like, posting me and stuff. So it's super cool.
Well, in the SEA Games, you know, you not only got the gold medal, but you broke a historic record that stood for quite a long time. I know you did from Lidia De Vega. And you actually declared that you were gonna do it eventually. I think you were short a bit the first time you said I was gonna break the record. Tell us a bit about that. Because I mean, for us non-athletes, we don't realize the difference of 0.1 second or 0.2 second in 100 or 200 meter dash, right? But for you guys, you know, it's a world of a difference. Tell us a bit about that and how you felt that was an attainable goal, that you knew that I can do this and I'm committing it, I'm promising it to the Philippines, I'm promising it to our kababayan that I can get this and make this record.
Initially, when I said that I was going to break it, I was still fresh into running for the Philippines. You know, my time wasn't really like dropping. I was still, you know, just trying to get used to my coach and stuff. But just our relationship and my trust with him, it has grown. And just seeing how the times were dropping at practice, I'm like, there's no way I'm going to keep running the same time. Mm-hmm. So that was when the confidence started building, was at practice and just seeing how, you know, my runs was going. And I was like, yeah, this record is coming down one way or another. When is the question? I have no idea, but it's going to come down and I'll be the one that's going to take it down. So.
And now you hold it. And I know your next goal is, I've heard you say this in several interviews, you're sick and tired of being in the 23s. Right?
Yes, I'm tired of running 23 seconds.
You know that the 22.9 is good enough for you.
Yeah, that's good enough.
You know that we're rooting for you, but how what's it like to prepare for that, to push yourself to that next level? I mean, I know the head of Patafa, Philip Wico, is actually a longtime family friend, and I know his passion for the sport for you guys, and I know the kind of support they're trying to give you guys, the world-class preparation and support team you need, because every little bit I've learned can really help you get that, you know, 1/100th of a second. So what has it been like since then, working towards your goal to make it to the Olympics and give it your best, you know, be a better version of you this time around?
You know, the timeline between the SEA Games and now, a lot has happened in between, you know, a lot of plan B in it, really. You know, there was no plan A at all, you know, within 2020 and 2021. So just the mentality to adjust has helped my mental game going into, you know, the Olympics, because it's not the original Olympics. I mean, I don't know what to compare it to, but just talking with, you know, ex-Olympians and people who've been where I am today, you know, talking with Eric, it's different, you know. So just having that in mind and, you know, not letting that like, kind of get in the way, you know, like every athlete is going through the pandemic, is going through these crazy protocols and stuff. So just knowing that I'm not alone and, you know, that's not going to stop them from going out and showing out. So I can't let that stop me either.
What was that like? I mean, what was it like going through the challenges of the pandemic and training and all that? We've heard from some other athletes it was really, really difficult, even for some of your Philippine teammates who were in the Philippines, because I know we were training in the U.S. and like Heidi and Diaz, I know she admitted she went through a rough patch during the pandemic. So how has it been like as a delegation and teammates, whether you who you've kept in contact with? What's that support been like amongst each other? Because it may be an individual sport, but, you know, it takes a whole village to prepare that individual athlete, right?
Yeah, well, for me, I like humor. So finding the humor in the pandemic is what kind of kept me sane. So I have a friend / another teammate. She is in California. She's a 400 hurdler for the Philippines as well, Robin Brown. And just me and her going back and forth of, oh, what crazy thing did we have to do today? You know, did we have to jump a fence? Did we get kicked off, you know, by the police? You know, we get like just those funny stories, you know, we can look back now and laugh about them. But in the moment, it was frustrating. But just knowing that I'm not alone in this, I'm not alone, you know, having to work out on grass instead of like a normal track or having to work out on asphalt. Like everyone was doing that, you know. So that was like that's what helped me was finding the humor in it all.
Well, you know, the home stretches of getting to the Olympics. And what is your mindset like right now? I know you've said in other interviews, you've said that I'm not just here to be a part of it. You know, we know you're in the current standings, it's not up there with the top, you know, medal potentials, but you're not settling just for that, right? You're not settling to just be a part of it. And that just shows a lot about your competitive nature. You know, there are some athletes who are like that, like, okay, I qualified and I'm going to enjoy this ride. But you're like, I'm going to go in this and really push myself to the limits. Tell us about that mindset of yours that you want to give it your best and you're not just content with just making it there.
The field that I'm in, everyone is star-studded, you know, everyone is out there to win it all, you know, and I want to be in the mix too. Like, I'm not trying to just be like, oh, I'm just happy to be here. And just with that in mind, you know, a lot of people are like, oh, like the Olympics, you reach the ultimate. It's like, this is just the beginning. I mean, maybe my like bar is like higher than most, but this is just the beginning. You know, we have Worlds coming up next year. The next Olympics is 3 years from now. So it's like, if I run faster than 23, I have a chance to actually qualify for Worlds, which is in 2022 in Oregon. So, you know, that's, I mean, obviously I'm seizing the moment now, but I'm also thinking beyond, like, you know, I'm trying to, if I can hit the time here, then we kill two birds with one stone. So that's how I'm looking at it.
All right. Well, I guess, you know, one thing we want to get from you is your message to other, you know, Filipinos out there all over the world, because there's a lot of you, like, you know, like Eric and other Filipino Americans, Filipino Brits, Filipino Germans who have realized that ability to, or that potential to, hey, I can compete for my motherland, for my mom's home country, for my dad's home country. What's your message to those young athletes who were, you know, like you in high school and college, it was in your mind. I mean, now that you've been a part of the Philippine team, you've been successful at that. What's your message to them out there in terms of whether they're on the fence or not and trying to make that dream a reality?
To make that dream a reality, I would say the biggest advice that I can give is being coachable and being adjustable. You know, pandemics, I mean, I'm hoping this is the last pandemic that we have to go through, but, you know, injuries happen as athletes, you know, different things happen. Cancellations, it's like, are you going to sit there and soak or are you going to adjust? And same thing with being coachable, you know. Throughout my years, I haven't had the same coach, you know, and you have to like relearn different coaching styles and you have to trust the process. So just being coachable and being able to adjust will make your career successful.
Well, you know, come the Olympic Games, you've got 110 million Filipinos in the Philippines rooting for you. You've got another 20 million Filipinos outside of the Philippines rooting for you. What is your message to all of them who'll be tuning in? They're going to be watching all 19 of you, you know, praying for you. What would you like to say back to them as the love you've been getting so far?
Thank you guys so much for the love and support that you guys have been showing me. I have a new uniform, so, and it's all white, so get ready to see that.
Exciting. Oh, exciting. Okay. Well, we can't wait to see you on the track. We're wishing all the best of health and strength in the last legs of your preparation. And we can't wait to see you out there carrying the Philippine flag proud once again, Christina. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you for having me.
And there you have it, Kapamilya, isang napaka magandang kwentuhan with our kababayan, si Christina Nat. And she's just one of the 19 athletes we have there in Tokyo representing the Philippines. Excited na tayong lahat para suportahan ang ating mga kababayan, and we wish them all the best to win the medals, to make the country proud, and to make us all united as we cheer on Team Philippines. Kayo, kapamilya, maraming salamat sa pagtutok dito sa TFC News. For those of you who want to reach more and read more about news and stories about the Filipinos outside the Philippines, please log on to their website, news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News. Maraming salamat, kapamilya. Ako po si TJ Manotong.